Who are civilians under IHL? As I noted in the introduction, Geneva Convention 4 is based on a territorial distinction between belligerent parties' own territory and an occupied territory. Accordingly, the Convention does not protect civilians who fall into the hands of the enemy during an invasion phase, before the territory can be considered to be occupied. Moreover, while Part 2 of Geneva Convention 4 applies to civilian population in general, Part 3 of this convention, which contains the most important provisions, apply to protected persons only. This notion, which is grounded on criteria of nationality and allegiance, further limits the scope of application of fundamental provisions of Geneva Convention 4. Let's study these two restrictions separately. The first restriction is the territorial limits of the convention. According to a traditional interpretation of Geneva Convention 4, only two types of territory are protected by this convention: a belligerent party's own territory and an occupied territory. This means that civilians who fall into the power of an invading force, which is not carrying out operations on its own territory, or which has not acquired control sufficiently to be treated as an occupying power, are left outside the scope of application of Geneva Convention 4. Therefore, such civilians are not protected by provisions contained in this convention, in particular by those prohibiting ill treatment, forcible deportation, or arbitrary detention. That said, some scholars have tried to overcome this shortcoming by calling for an expanded interpretation of the terms occupied territory, known as functional theory of occupation. We consider this theory when examining the scope of application of IHL. Others have proposed that certain provisions contained in Section 1 of Part 3 of Geneva Convention 4 also apply during the invasion phase. The second restriction limits Part 3 of the Convention to protected persons. Protected persons under Article 4 of Geneva Convention 4 are all persons who are not considered as nationals of the party to the conflict or of the occupying power in whose hands they are, and who are not protected by Geneva Convention 1, 2, and 3. This second restriction calls for two observations. First observation: the nationality criterion entails that the law applicable to protected persons during international armed conflicts, Part 3 of Geneva Convention 4, does not cover the treatment reserved by state parties with regard to their own nationals. The relationship between a state and its nationals is governed by national law, human rights law, and the general regime for the protection of civilians contained in Part 2 of Geneva Convention 4. However, both the ICTY and the ICC have interpreted Article 4 of Geneva Convention 4 as also including individuals who owe allegiance to the opposing party to the conflict, although they might possess the same nationality as those in whose hands they had fallen. This interpretation has broadened the concept of protected person by including other ties based on allegiance or ethnicity. These criteria are, however, difficult to verify in practice and introduce some degree of subjectivity into the application of IHL. I shall note, in this regard, that Geneva Convention 4 excludes from its scope of application nationals of neutral or co-belligerent states with normal diplomatic representation. Before turning to my second observation, I should emphasize that Part 2 of Geneva Convention 4 lays down some general rules on aid and relief for all civilians independently of any criterion of nationality or allegiance. In other words, civilians who do not qualify for protected person under Part 3 of Geneva Convention 4 because they do not meet the nationality or allegiance requirement are protected by the general safeguards contained in Part 2 of the same convention. Second observation: the concept of civilians, civilian population or protected person, is defined negatively. It encompasses any person who does not belong to one of the categories of persons who are referred to in Article 4, 8, 1, 2, 3, and 6 of Geneva Convention 3. As emphasized by the Pictet commentary, it flows from this that all persons of ethnic nationals who are not entitled to POW status are, in principle, civilians protected by Geneva Convention 4, so that there is no gap in protection. This should be borne in mind when some states, like the United States, have contended that unlawful combatants, that is, civilians who participate in hostilities without having the right to do so, are not entitled to any protection whatsoever under IHL. It is true that these persons can hardly fall under the categories of POWs unless they meet the conditions imposed by Article 482 of Geneva Convention 4 to be treated as irregular armed forces. However, maintaining that Geneva Convention 4 excludes them ab initio from protection because they have illegally participated in the hostilities is not in line with the above definition of civilians. I shall indeed repeat that, according to the ICRC and most scholars, such definitions include all persons who are not entitled to POW status, whether they participate or not in the hostilities.